Well, I'm not sure that we're ever going to get back to a normal level of operations. In fact, I've heard it called the new abnormal.
Welcome to the Canadian Army Podcast. I'm Lieutenant Adam Wharton, and today we're going to be talking about the Army's response to COVID-19. I'm here with Lieutenant General Wayne Eyre, Commander of the Canadian Army. Good day, sir.
How are you doing, Adam?
I'm great. How are you?
Excellent. Excellent. Thanks for the opportunity and thanks for your willingness to lead this effort in launching a Canadian Army podcast.
Thanks, sir. It's going to be a great first episode and we're hoping for many more. So COVID-19 has kind of given us an excuse to kick off this podcast. Why are we doing a podcast and why are we doing now?
Well, the environment that we find ourselves in with COVID-19 has provided us an opportunity to experiment with different forms of communication. And as we've realized, as we've gone through this this emergency, the communication and the need to over-communicate is so important. I'm a big fan of podcasts myself. I subscribe to many. It's a great way of absorbing information while you're concurrently doing something else. Whether it's PT, whether it's driving, so it's a great way to further your own development and knowledge. And so here in Army headquarters, we've been using a number of different methods to get the word out, to pass on key messages. And the podcast is just another tool in the toolbox that we want to experiment with. So I've instructed the Army Public Affairs team here to make sure this podcast appeals to the broadest range of members of our Army, whether it's regular reserve officers, NCOs, NCMs, Anglophone, Francophone, family members, spouses, kids, retired members, all part of our extended Army family. So this is a big audience to reach, and not every episode will be specific to that audience. However, we hope to get a good enough spectrum of different episodes that there will be something of interest to everybody. And some of these episodes will be tailored to specific groups. And so I just want to highlight that, especially now during this time of crisis with COVID-19, it is so important to over-communicate. And this is just another venue for us to pass on messages and allow those out there who are physically distancing to remain connected to our Army.
I find it really interesting that you mentioned kind of the new mechanisms of communication, kind of the over-communication that's been taking place. And we kind of see that in how the interactions have changed between the chain of command and now, you know, members on the ground level are receiving communication directly from the top, either from the CAF or the Army level. How do you feel about that change in the way we communicate? Do you think that has an impact on the chain of command's capacity of doing what they need to do? Is it better to be able to have those direct comms?
So I can see both sides of the argument here. But this is really nothing new, as those at the top level have always put out, whether it's speeches or other forms of communication. And a podcast is just another form of that communication, and it's not a substitute for the chain of command, which absolutely has to take primacy. So as I mentioned, in times of crisis, we need to over-communicate. And I'm a believer that the more times you hear a message through different forms, the more likely you are to internalize that message. So our podcasts, our videos, our other online messaging are just meant to supplement and help explain our overall intent. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. And leaders at all levels should not be threatened by that. And what we pass out at this level is more intent. And, you know, there can be some specifics that are part of that that message, but generally it's overall intent that commanders at every level, as orders are filtered down the chain of command, they scale those orders and they make them applicable to their local set of circumstances. So there should be no incongruence between what the CDS says, what I say, what gets passed down to division commanders, and then applied by the chain of command down the chain. And so the chain of command always has primacy here. So once again, social media, podcasts, the like, they're all meant to complement and not compete with the chain of command.
And that makes a lot of sense because you know, there is definitely a difference between, you know, issuing orders and having, you know, a regular kind of conversation like we're having where we can kind of talk about ideas. And it's good for, or from my perspective anyways, it seems good that, you know, troops also get to be involved and witness kind of the conversation that takes place before a 17-page op order gets dropped or something along those lines. So the current state as it is for COVID-19 for the Army and kind of our emergency response to it, we've kind of adapted our communication methods, but we've done a couple other things also. You know, non-critical staff are not coming into work. Bases have been partially shut down. People are working from home now, which is something that's a relatively new evolution. And even things that have been kind of a constant within Army life, such as active posting season, or APS for people who've never heard that term before, is being extended even into October now. Are you happy with the way that the Army has been responding to this?
I'm very happy with the way that the Army has responded to this unprecedented situation. You know, back in January and in February, we had no idea as to the magnitude of this, and there are still significant uncertainties out there. So by putting a large portion of the Army on standby to support Op Laser and forming virtual or assembled task forces has been, in my view, a success. Now, we haven't been called upon to provide the large number of forces that that were a potential back at that time, but we're not out of this yet. You know, and likewise, the climate has cooperated. So we haven't seen the flooding that we've seen in previous years. And so we've been very lucky from that perspective. But that being said, we have stood ready, ready to respond, and we remain in that posture. Now, I'm also very happy that the force protection measures that we put in place have been well adhered to. If you take a look at the infection rate of COVID across the Army, we are significantly lower than the rest of the population. And that shows to me that what we've put in place for health force protection is working, and we've got to keep it up. Now, I know with Op Laser, we've been surprised with some of the tasks that we've received so far. Very non-traditional ones for an organization that is optimized to close with and destroy the enemy. But that being said, we are putting on this uniform subjects us to ultimate liability, part and parcel of which is conducting all operations that the government deems appropriate for us. And so whether it's going overseas and doing our nation's bidding or back home protecting Canadians, that is our role. Our soldiers have embraced this spirit of service above self, the spirit of community service, and I'm extremely proud of the work that our members are doing. But this pandemic has had a huge impact on our country and our Army, and we've taken extraordinary measures to deal with it. We ceased training. We significantly cut down on the number of headquarters staff that were coming into work. To the degree possible, we've been teleworking, working from home using technology. But this is having an impact on our readiness, and we do need to get back to ensuring that we are ready to respond to all contingencies. Our posting plot has very much slowed down. And so posting messages are flowing now. Very shortly, we're going to get some direction out on conduct of house hunting trips and how the posting season will unfold. And it'll be a long posting season. It'll go right up until December to make sure that we can move in a safe and well-disciplined manner. So this is an unprecedented situation, at least during the time that we've served. And there are lots of unknowns. And so going through this is going to take a degree of patience to deal with the inevitable frustrations that are out there.
Sir, you made a comment, and maybe if you'd be willing to expand on that. I know most troops are familiar with the concept of unlimited liability, and kind of it's always in the back of our minds as we do our tasks and duties that, you know, we can be exposed to greater risk than the average person. Can you just elaborate a little bit on that for perhaps civilians who may not be familiar with that concept, what that means?
Yes, we put this uniform on. We are expected to serve our country. And in many cases, that means undertaking tasks or missions that put ourselves at risk for the greater good. That's all about service. That's all about service to this country, to make sure that our national interests and values are protected. And most of all, our people, our citizens are protected here at home.
Great. Thanks. So we're kind of in this emergency mode right now. Again, we're kind of preserving the force, as you mentioned. Eventually, we're going to have to resume our normal level of operations. What's that process going to look like for us?
Well, I'm not sure that we're ever going to get back to a normal level of operations. In fact, I've heard it called the new abnormal. But we are putting significant planning into getting the machine going again. And I expect to get orders out on this over the course of the next week or so. But this is going to change the way we do business significantly. But as we get back to ensuring that our routine functions are able to get done, we're going to take a very disciplined and incremental approach to ensure that our readiness is protected, is built, maintained, and our forces are able to go off and do what we're needed for. You know, whether that's overseas or here at home. So that's readiness to fight an adversary on short notice. That's readiness to conduct domestic operations. That's readiness to go do the variety of missions that we expect overseas. So where does that readiness come from? Well, it's rooted in our doctrine, but it's built through training, through ensuring our equipment is ready, and through making sure we got people in the right place to do the work. We are an essential service for the protection and the defense of Canada, and we have to view ourselves as such. So as we turn the machine back on, I like to use the analogy of an NHL team, you know, very appropriate for us as Canadians. And you think of an NHL team that's about to compete in the playoffs, but all of a sudden gets shut down, gets sent home. Some of them get employed on other tasks, you know, filling sandbags, for example. But they're not skating. They're not, for the most part, interacting face-to-face with their teammates. So after several months, they're rusty. Their timing is off. They may have forgotten the plays from their playbooks. So you wouldn't expect them to get right back on the ice and play a playoff game. There's going to be work to do to get them up to that level. They need to train individually. They need to get their skating and stick handling and puck handling skills back to standard. They need time to do this as individuals, as a group, and as a team. But also the rest of the machine has been not at work. So the coaching staff, all of the support staff, their medical staff, and then the pipeline, the farm teams that provide them the additional players. They've not been playing or generating players either. So that system has to be turned back on. So you can see there's a huge analogy, very appropriate analogy for what we do in the Canadian Army. To be able to answer the call in this dangerous, volatile, and unpredictable world. So we got to be smart about how we do this. It's got to be a deliberate, phased, and prioritized approach to how we do this. We're looking at doing this in a number of steps. And of course, it's going to be in a COVID-active environment. So we got to have the force health protection measures in place. So what we're doing right now is making sure that we've got the conditions in place. The training, the drills, the planning to be able to resume the machine. And that's going to be the second stage, is we have a gradual return to work, more and more people into the workplace, observing these measures, undertaking some of the prioritized functions that we need to accomplish. After which, and I expect the time between the second phase and the third phase, or the second stage and the third stage, to be relatively short, we're going to start our individual training. We got to get the training machine, the personal production pipeline, going again to ensure that we've got the personnel strength. So our BMQs, our DP1s, our PLQs, both on the regular and reserve side, to ensure that we've got the people. We've got to continue to grow junior leaders, and you're going to see a focus on that carry on into the fall as well. I'm very, very keen on getting our reserve individual training going again. It'll be in a much more decentralized manner across the country, but we've got many non-BMQ qualified recruits out there that we can't employ on Class C that we need to get trained so that they themselves can be employed and we can continue to grow our reserves. You know, likewise on the regular force, we have many who are personnel awaiting training that we need to get back onto their DP1 training so that they get qualified. As we restart the Canadian Forces Leadership and Recruit School in Saint-Jean as well, you know, given the COVID environment, some of that BMQ training will have to be decentralized, and we're actively looking at how we're going to do that as well to bring some of that BMQ training into the Army. But this approach is going to be conditions-based, and it's going to be asymmetric across the country as local situations dictate. So you can see training restart, you can see our business restart in some parts of the country, whereas in others it may lag a little bit. We've got to have the battle drills in place. If we have a second wave, if we have a resurgence of COVID infections, what immediate actions do we need to take in case we have infections in some of our student body, some of the candidates going through courses? How do we immediately isolate them to preserve the force protection, preserve the health of the rest of the group so we can continue on with that training? This is really going to be that new abnormal. So the drills that we have, the force protection measures that we take, the physical distancing, that's all going to continue. So our medical experts, the Canadian Army surgeon, they've all played an integral part in developing this plan. And we're going to do everything we can to keep our military and civilian staff safe as we build this readiness.
Now, you made a mention earlier on also of being ready and having that level of readiness. Pretty much, there's not a single soldier in the world who hasn't stood around in a circle at one point and discussed the philosophy of how the military works. And I think one of the challenges that we face on an ongoing basis is kind of the uncertainty of the future. Whereas in maybe, for example, different organizations would have a clear objective of what's to happen next and how to get there. I kind of see from what you've been saying that, you know, we don't always know what's next, but we must be ready to respond to what's next.
No, that is absolutely true. So this uncertainty in the bigger scheme of things is not new. Military in our role, the Army in our role, has always faced a degree of uncertainty because let's remember, the enemy gets a vote. And whether that enemy is human or viral in nature, we have to be able to respond.
That's right. The enemy always gets a vote. So, sir, do you have any final thoughts for people out there listening, whether it be civilian or military?
Yeah, I've got a couple of final thoughts here. We're going to be in this for some time, and so resiliency is absolutely critical. Take care of yourself, take care of your families, stay resilient. Use this time to keep your immune system strong with daily physical activity, good nutrition, good sleep. Healthy social activities where you can connect with your peers and friends as you can. This is going to take significant discipline and vigilance, which we are known for. And so keep it up, stay disciplined, observe the health force protection measures, and be ready.
All right, perfect. Well, thanks very much, sir. Really appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you.
This has been the Canadian Army Podcast. If you liked what you heard, please subscribe. Also, don't forget our social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. And don't forget to leave that feedback. We're going to try and make shows about things that you're interested in. So if you have an idea, don't hesitate to shoot it to us either through those platforms or via the email address also listed in the podcast description. Stay frosty.